local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, here we are. There you are. Everybody's in place. Everybody in place? Okay. Tim, are you in place?
I'm in place.
Dave, are you in place?
I am in place. Okay. And here's the thing. It's a little dark outside.
It is, yeah.
It seems to me, and maybe I'm wrong, but this is just my own experience. It seems to be getting darker each day.
Really?
Yeah.
That's quite an observation.
Wasn't that long ago when we would get here and open the blind, and it was nice and sunny outside, and we could say, oh, my goodness, look how beautiful it is. Now I just say, look how dark it is.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, weather-wise, we had that gorgeous day yesterday.
Yeah.
I hope you enjoyed it. Today's high is going to be 60.
That's nice.
But showers likely. You know, it's going to rain. We've got about starting with a 60% chance and then dropping to a 30% chance. In any event, it's not going to be a washout, but we're going to have rain with maybe a tenth of an inch or something like that. But still, wet is wet, right?
Wet is wet, but 60 degrees is not uncomfortable. If it was colder than that with rain, then that could be a little bit uncomfortable. But I would say we'll be okay today.
Yeah, cloudy and 50
it's
tonight.
It's an okay day.
Cloudy and 61 tomorrow, and then Friday night showers before 2 in the morning, so overnight. And then rain from that point on. We're going to be a low around 52. And I'm wondering, there's a lot of really important high school football games Friday.
Oh, yeah, right.
And it's kind of, we don't know. It definitely some, about 100% chance of showers Friday night. But what time will that start? That's the big question.
Right.
Will we make it to the end of the game?
And unless it's thunderstorms with lightning, they're playing anyway.
That's
so you're
true.
Just playing the slop,
right. Mm-hmm.
You know. And so, yeah, that football is not caused because of rain, but lightning. Now that's a different story.
Yeah, I don't. I know the players would love to play in any weather.
Yeah, I'm going to say sometimes they prefer the slop.
That's right.
Particularly if you're facing a superior team, sometimes that would kind of even the score a little bit.
Yeah, but as a spectator,
yeah.
I'm sorry, it's got to be a nice night for me.
I didn't play football, but I played basketball, and we would often pray that the power would go out during the game so that the gym would be dark, so that we would maybe somewhat equalize the team that we were playing if neither of us could see.
Uh-huh. Well, I see how that works.
Yeah. Yep.
You could have had neon lights on your uniforms or something like that. That would
never
help.
Never happened, but anyway. I remember one game, this is true, one game we scored, and this was the plan, score the first 2 points, play defense, and then hold the ball.
Oh, there you go.
Against a team that, Dublin, Ohio, in fact, I remember the team, and they were much better than us, and it worked for the first half, actually, and I think the score at halftime was like 6-2, 6-4, or something like that, and we ended up losing, you know, 18-8 or something in high school basketball. So, hey.
Yeah, wow, that's such a way back machine.
Otherwise, it was going to be 100-4.
Got to have your strategy. Yeah, no question about that.
I thought it was a good strategy.
It's called letting the air out of the ball.
This is what the coach said, basically. We have no chance to win. Let's just not let them score 100. And we said, okay, sounds good.
We'll lose, but we'll look good losing.
Yeah, that's right. And we're holding the ball after we score 2, and they're looking at us like, what are you doing?
You know what you should have done? You should have found out about Flubber.
Flubber. Oh, yeah.
See, I like the original Flubber with Fred McMurray.
Bouncing around.
All the remakes are always a little less.
Hey, early voting began.
Oh, it starts.
And I guess here in Lucas County, the Board of Elections, they had like a trickle of people coming through.
Mm.
So not this huge rush, which is, I think, a good sign.
So that's first day. So hopefully it'll continue with a consistent flow.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people really like to wait to election day, and I understand that. But really, this vote is so important. I wouldn't put it off till then. When you have an opportunity to go vote.
Right.
It counts the same. And then you eliminate the idea that something might happen on election day where you might not be available to vote.
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
There you go.
Always a good idea to be prepared, and seeing more and more vote no signs popping up, which is good.
Yeah,
I'm with you. An editorial in the Toledo Blade urges a no vote.
Yeah, so that's good.
Yeah.
And I did see the advertisement with our governor, Governor DeWine, and his wife. And boy, was, you know, look, it was good. I just thought it was good. It brought in to the point that it's just too extreme for Ohio. You'd like for them to say every life is sacred. We ought to protect it from the moment of conception till natural death. But their spot got done what it needed to get done for particular issue. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, there you go.
That's good. All right. We've got a busy, 20 minutes here coming up.
Yeah.
Because we're gonna spotlight this. It's Thursday. Bishop's
Corner.
Yeah,
I love our Thursdays. Yeah.
So what question among the five that are part of today's Bishop's Corner program, which airs about what time? This afternoon?
Yeah, 4 o'clock. Hey, and here's the thing. If you weren't with us last week, this is a new segment. So what we're doing is we take, as Ron said, one of the five questions, highlight one of the questions from today's program, play that for you as a bit of what we call a teaser.
Yeah.
And then obviously you can listen to the entire program later today at 4 o'clock, the Bishop's Corner.
4:30.
4:30. I'm sorry.
Right.
So I hope you'll tune in at 4 o'clock as well for Say Yes to Life, followed by the Bishop's Corner. But in any case, you get this one question. And now, who chooses that? Is that you or when I say you, there are two people in studio here.
When we,
producer Tim when we and
record,
Ron Finn.
When we record those Bishop's Corners,
yeah,
Bishop and Ron Miller. In the case of today's, Ron was not there, so it was me.
Yeah,
and then a couple of the staff.
Yeah.
So we're all in the room at the same time, and we're looking over the questions, and usually after he's given his answer and everything. Then we'll look at him and say, well, which one do you think? And the bishop picks the one that...
So he's the one picking it. Oh, I like that. So
we're not making some executive decision here. We're
letting fabulous.
Him pick the
question. This is the bishop's choice for which one he wants everyone on Morning Offering to hear.
That'd be great.
Well, I'm glad I asked.
Yeah, and we've got, of course, Wendy's news today. She's going to go on vacation starting tomorrow, so we won't have her news for about a week.
Wow.
Yeah.
What shall we do?
Well, I think we'll make something up.
We like the fact that Wendy doesn't make anything up.
That's right.
She actually uses real news.
That's right.
Stay tuned.
Does.
We don't know what will happen for the next week.
Yes, and, of course, all kinds of stuff going on. And I want to mention this on the we're just watching all this unfold there at the Gaza Strip.
Oh, yeah.
And, it's getting worse and worse and worse. We got to keep praying for that. Now, the last operational power plant in Gaza went offline yesterday.
Yeah.
So running out of fuel after Israel fully closed the two entry points into the area, which prohibits the transport of food, fuel, water, and more. Their whole plan cut everything off at the Gaza Strip, which is where Hamas is leading its attack.
Yeah, and I understand, again, why they're doing it, but we're talking about cutting off fuel, water, medicine. Mm-hmm. Medicine. Imagine there are hospitals over there that now have no ability to get medicine. There are people who are scheduled for surgeries in very difficult situations. And so this is the reality. The death toll in Israel, primarily from the initial attack and almost entirely civilians, has risen to at least 1,200. At least 22 Americans. Mm-hmm. At least 22 Americans were reported to be among those killed. At least 1,100 Palestinians, including children, though sources vary on exact figures, have been killed in retaliatory strikes by Israel. The fate of an estimated 150 hostages taken in Gaza remains unknown. Hamas officials threatened to execute hostages in response to unannounced airstrikes. So. And no reports yet of that particular thing happened. So here, this is what where we always have to begin. This is the responsibility of Hamas.
Mm-hmm.
Hamas went forward and attacked Israel.
Yeah.
Israel's responses are because of the attack that was on them. But, it's just, we've got to pray because these are human beings in the Gaza Strip. And we often forget that, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
These are human beings. And quite frankly, this is where our Christian brothers and sisters live too. And we've got another story about the only Catholic church in that area. The Latin Catholic Patriarch of, the only Catholic church, I've got that, pastor of only Catholic church in Gaza.
Father Gabriel Romanelli.
Never have we seen things like this time. Never before. Now, he's a pastor of the only Catholic church in Gaza. I guarantee you, he's seen some things.
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying he's never seen anything like this before.
Wow. And they have in their parish more than 80 Christians and other Muslim neighbors who are in their school have requested accommodation there. So,
yeah.
What a difficult situation.
And that is the, you know, what a difficult situation. I think that is that wraps this up in a bow. I mean, this is a difficult situation without easy answers. But for us, those of us who are believers, we just know one thing, that these are human beings, both in Israel and on the Gaza Strip. And we just need to pray for the protection of the innocent. We need to pray that that those who perpetrated this attack are brought to justice. I mean, that's a good thing. That they need, and maybe if we can do that, then we can kind of calm everything down a little bit and protect the lives of the innocent. So we continue to do what our Holy Father has asked us to do, pray. But now also the Catholic Patriarch calls for a day of prayer and fasting for peace in the Holy Land. The Catholic Patriarch of Jerusalem has called for a day of prayer and fasting on October 17th. So Tuesday, October 17th, so next this coming Tuesday, Cardinal Pizzabella has urged Catholics to organize times of prayer with Eucharistic adoration and recitation of the Rosary to deliver to God the Father our thirst for peace, justice, and reconciliation.
Yeah, he goes on to say, in this time of sorrow and dismay, we do not want to remain helpless. We cannot let death and its sting be the only word we hear. He's referring to 1 Corinthians 15:55.
Yeah, that is why we feel the need to pray, to turn our hearts to God the Father. Only in this way can we draw the strength and serenity needed to endure these hard times by turning to Him in prayer and intercession to implore and cry out to God amidst this anguish. So that's the Patriarch of Jerusalem. We're hearing from him. We're hearing from the pastor of the only Catholic church in the Gaza Strip. We're obviously hearing from our Holy Father, all saying the same thing. Mm-hmm. Peace, let there be peace, and a resolution to this current conflict that is costing the lives of many, but not only costing the lives of many, putting at risk many, 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 many more lives, and the opportunity for this to grow to other nations and all of that. So we really need to be praying that peace reigns very soon.
And fasting, of course, a very important element as well. There's power in fasting, so Amen. Prayer and fasting, definitely what's called for. Mm. All right, just about 7:46 now. And, you know, before we look ahead, why don't we find out what happened, at some point in time in our past? It's always good to kind of look at that, don't you think?
Always good.
So let's do it. Producer Tim's in studio with a look at
Today in History.
Yes, everything that was from way back when. So on this date, 1492, New World is cited as it was discovered when the Pinta, which was captained by Christopher Columbus, was landed on San Salvador on this day, which will cap off the historic voyage that Christopher Columbus had from Spain. 1901, President Theodore Roosevelt officially changing the name of the president's residence at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington from the Executive Mansion to the White House.
Mm.
Otherwise, I mean,
power of a paint job, huh?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I couldn't even imagine calling it the Executive Mansion, you know. I mean, because it's just so ingrained to say White House now. 1997, John Denver died when an experimental amateur aircraft crashed into Monterey Bay on the California coast. What a wonderful singer he was. He certainly is. So, and 2000, the USS Cole, a U.S. naval destroyer, was attacked by suicide bombers associated with Al-Qaeda. 17 sailors killed, 39 wounded. We pray for their souls and for those that were wounded in that terrorist attack. Celebrity birthdays, actors Hugh Jackman, 55, Kirk Cameron, who you know from a lot of Christian films, 53, and former Fox News anchor Chris Wallace is 76. Mm-hmm. Farmers Day today. I apparently I misspelled that. They forgot the R.
Famers, yeah. They should be famous. Let's just say
also
that.
Yes, Famers Day. We want to welcome all those photographic people.
That's right. Day of Respect for Cultural Diversity, National Pulled Pork Day. That's something I can agree with. Yeah. And World Arthritis Day. So we remember all those who suffer from arthritis. So that's this day in history.
That's wonderful.
History.
Farmers Day today.
Farmers Day. Boy, and is that important in our listening area and throughout our country? In fact, my bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't pays tribute to the farmers today. So
perfect.
Stay tuned for that.
Yeah, absolutely. Stay tuned for everything, including Wendy's news. She's going to bring us up to date.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning in the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio. I'm Wendy Sheridan. Toledo police say a 14-year-old Woodward High School student overdosed at the school yesterday. A report finds the student used a dab pen similar to a vape before it happened. The student was given Narcan, then taken to the hospital. The Lucas County Drug Abuse Response Team says one danger people face when they do drugs is that they might not know what they're taking. It could be laced with other things. TPS confirms it does have overdose-reducing drug Narcan available at schools. Two ProMedica facilities are set to close within the month. The company announced its home health facilities in Clyde and Dundee will close next month. ProMedica released a statement saying it's part of a strategy to get out of the home health care business. The health care system says it's working with staff to help them find new jobs and checking in with patients to make sure the transition is a smooth one. Bittersweet Farms celebrating 40 years of service helping people living with autism. There are three locations in Ohio where participants grow and develop their abilities and talents in an agricultural setting. Bittersweet Farms expected to celebrate its past 40 years while looking forward to what's next. Tens of thousands of Israeli troops gathering at the border of Gaza, preparing for a likely ground invasion. President Biden called last weekend's Hamas attack on Israel the deadliest day for Jews since the Holocaust and a campaign of pure cruelty. Israeli airstrikes have been pummeling Gaza for days, leaving many neighborhoods in rubble. On Capitol Hill, Republicans nominated Louisiana Congressman Steve Scalise to be the next Speaker of the House. He narrowly defeated Ohio Congressman Jim Jordan to win his party's nomination. It's not clear when the whole House will vote for a new Speaker. A significant expansion in the auto workers' strike. 8,700 workers at Ford's largest plant walked off the job yesterday. UAW President Sean Fain said the strike was called at the Kentucky truck plant in Louisville after Ford failed to update its contract offer. The automaker is calling the move grossly irresponsible. Researchers in Germany reporting artificial intelligence, or AI, is rapidly improving skin cancer detection. Data shows new software can correctly identify 99.5% of all skin cancers, including 100% of melanoma cases. But healthcare officials also say patients need to consult a dermatologist and not rely solely on artificial intelligence. Somebody's a whole lot richer this morning. One winning ticket for the $1.765 billion Powerball jackpot was sold in California. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, a very fall-like forecast through the weekend. Rainy today with a high near 60, clouds and 62 tomorrow, and chances of rain again Saturday and Sunday with highs in the upper 50s. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Up to 50 degrees, that's not bad.
No, all the way up to 60 today. Should be a pleasant day, but with some rain.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
We'll endure it.
That's right.
We shall endure.
So what is the burning question bubbling through the cacophony of questions that the bishop is addressing this afternoon on the Bishop's Corner?
Yeah, I can't wait to see which one of the five he picked.
So here it is from today's show. This is the highlight question of the week. You're going to hear my voice. I'm not normally the host of
Ron Miller.
I'm the backup Ron.
But you do it with some frequency.
I filled in for Ron for this one. So here's the question. We're going to go to Samantha at St. Joseph, Sylvania. Dear Bishop Thomas, how often do you suggest people pray each day when beginning to develop a routine of making prayer part of their daily schedule? Are there any devotions or prayers that you rely on that you feel would be particularly helpful? Thank you, Samantha.
Samantha, what a great question. And if I may suggest, if you're asking this question, it sounds to me you would benefit from visiting with a priest in spiritual direction. If you're so serious, and I'm so proud of you, about forming a habit of prayer. And I use that word intentionally, Samantha, because you say develop a routine of making prayer a part of their daily schedule. And, you know, St. Thomas Aquinas calls that, Samantha, the habitus. It's the good habit. Now, we all have bad habits, right? We don't want to mention them. But habits are something that are repeated and can either be for the good or the bad. Well, prayer is often nourished because it becomes a habit, sometimes a habit that you have to really work at. So make your prayer a habit. I would say, Samantha, maybe start simply, if you have not already a plan, if you will, and a habit of prayer. That may simply mean a morning offering. In the morning, it might mean a midday stop and praying to the Lord, and it might mean at nighttime a brief examine of conscience. So I would start with planning, just like somebody does exercising, right? They have the habit of exercising to become physically strong. So this is the habit of scheduling prayer to become spiritually more in tune with God's will and more in tune with the Holy Spirit who desires to guide you in your life and whatever your vocation is. So I would say then all these other things can follow, right? You know, devotions, time of Eucharistic adoration, meditation on sacred scripture, all those things can follow, but start it simple. And you know, you've heard me say this, I'm sure, Samantha, if you listen or watch, and I always say, is it doable? Is it practical? Is it achievable? And you ask, what do you rely on? I rely on the habit, and the discipline of that habit is crucial. So I offer you those prayers and promise my prayer for you and everyone who's watching and listening, who's working at forming the habit of prayer. Thank you, Samantha.
Can't wait to hear the whole show.
I love how the Bishop Thomas is so good at threes. He always gives you everything, and I love it because you can remember it. Mm-hmm. So here he says on this habit of prayer, of course, doable, practical, achievable. Mm-hmm. You know, and so because so often we set ourselves up for failure because, oh my goodness, I'm going to do 8 rosaries a day. I'm going to have 3 hours of adoration. I'm going to, blah, blah, you know, and it's not achievable. It's mm-hmm. not doable. Yeah. And so what do you do? What can you set in your schedule that's doable, practical, and achievable? Thank you, Bishop Thomas. Love it.
Just one of 5 questions featured this afternoon at 4:30 on the Bishop's Corner. Of course, we played that about 3 times, but the initial airing is this afternoon, so make sure you're listening. And, of course, those questions, we'd love to get those questions.
Yeah.
So send them on in, bishop@annunciationradio.com.
Gotta love it. He answers all questions. He wants a name. You know, we don't do anonymous here. Mm-hmm. So first name and your parish. That's all we're asking for. First name and your parish. And then the bishop answers those questions. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you, over the years, we've given him questions I thought maybe he wouldn't address. Mm-hmm. They were a little kind of gotcha sometimes and some other things. And he still addresses them.
He doesn't reject
questions. He's so fabulous. Yeah.
All comers. He takes them all.
Yeah. Doable, practical, achievable. I like that.
Yeah,
good
me too.
Stuff.
That's pretty good. I wonder, let's see, as far as tomorrow's morning show, it's Friday.
Yeah.
There's always a tendency to want to sleep in on Friday, but is it doable? Is it practical? I guess I'll be here.
We're hoping so. It'd be 50% okay, let's be honest. I talk more than 50% of the time, so 45% of the time, there would be silence.
That's right. All right, coming up in the hour ahead here, of course, we'll pray for our priests, the word of the day from Dave, and then later from Andrew Reinhardt. And, one doesn't belong. So we're going to give you that quiz today that maybe people can help out with.
Again, in anticipation of Matthew Archibald, go to creativeminorityreport.com. Yeah. Our conversation will be based on the articles that he has written there.
Yeah, he's coming up at 8:20. Welcome aboard, Morning Offering for Thursday here on Annunciation Radio.
People are talking about Annunciation Radio.
Being a lifelong Catholic, there are questions that I haven't even thought of to ask, and the answers come back immediately.
Faith with Frequency, Annunciation Radio.
Do you have something you'd like to ask our bishop? Most Reverend Daniel Lee Thomas answers questions from our listeners each and every week on the Bishop's Corner. Send in your questions about the faith, today's cultural trends, diocesan news and events, prayer life, anything on your mind. Click the Bishop's Corner tab at AnnunciationRadio.com or on our app and listen for his answer Thursdays at 4:30 p.m., Fridays at 11, and Saturdays at noon on Annunciation Radio.
Annunciation Radio would like to thank Masick Custom Builders for providing underwriting support. For more than 25 years, Masick Custom Builders has been offering custom home construction and renovation services throughout Northwest Ohio and Southeast Michigan. You may reach Masick Custom Builders at 419-861-7773. Online at MasickCustomBuilders.com. That's M-A-C-E-K CustomBuilders.com.
This is the day. This is the theme for this year's annual Catholic Appeal. Hello, everyone. Bishop Daniel Thomas here. Day by day, all of us are blessed by our Lord, and we know that as Catholics, we're charged with sharing our blessings with others. Your participation in our annual Catholic Appeal brings immediate help to individuals and families in crisis with food, counseling, care, and compassion. Your gift assists in Catholic education of our young people, promotes our priestly vocations, provides liturgical resources throughout our diocese, and so much more. This is the day. I invite you this day to please give generously to our annual Catholic Appeal at your parish or online at acatoledo.org. So grateful for your generosity to our annual Catholic Appeal. We depend on your goodness. God bless you.
Catholic Radio for the Diocese of Toledo. This is Annunciation Radio. WNOC Bowling Green Toledo. WHRQ Sandusky. WRRO Eden Bryan. WFOT Lexington Mansfield. And WSHB Willard.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And we are back. It's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave, where we love to give advice when we can, when we feel like we are qualified to do it. And right. I will say there's a story in the news, and I'm thrilled that I can give some advice toward this one because it's kind of a big deal. A radiator circuit on the ISS is leaking. The International Space Station. I'm sorry, is leaking. This from CNN World. The Russian space agency is searching for answers after one of its modules on the International Space Station sprang a coolant leak, adding to the list of mechanical issues the space agency has grappled with in low Earth orbit over the past year. This is, again, and they're looking for answers, they have a coolant leak. And so this one I can help with, finally. You know, you always look for these big stories. How can I be helpful? Here's the thing. I have experienced this.
Yeah.
I had when I was a youngster, I had a 1979 Chevy Monza. A Monza. M-O-N-D-Z-A. That was one of my first cars. And I had a coolant leak.
Mm-hmm.
Now, back in the day, you just buy this. I went to this guy, and he said, look, this is what you want to do. You want to go down, you want to buy this stuff, you put it in the radiator, then you sell the car. I didn't like that part. But he said, it'll probably hold that radiator for a year or so. And it did.
Huh.
And so what I want to encourage the folks at the Russian Space Center to do, go to your local AutoZone.
Mm-hmm.
O'Reilly's, any of those, and say, I have a coolant leak.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll sell you this gunk that you put in that radiator, and it fills in the hole. I've drove that Monza for another 2 or 3 years, and I didn't have an issue with that radiator, and I was so thankful for it. And so, again, I'm just thrilled that I can play a part in this. Go to your local auto parts place. Let them know that you've got a leak in the radiator. They'll sell you this liquid. It's really thick.
Well, there you go.
And then you just put it in there, and bam, it glums. I don't know if you're familiar with the word glums, but
yeah,
it means it sticks. It sticks. It goes into that thing. It finds the hole, and bam, it covers it up.
Can you imagine, you know, you send an HVAC crew for a service call. What a service call to the International Space Station would cost.
Well, there you go.
Wow, yeah, that's
so expensive. I don't know. I don't know if you have any of this radiator plugging stuff up there, but yeah. If you don't,
you know what they
next
say?
Trip up, take some up.
There are no convenience stores.
We'll land between 9 to 1 or 1 2 to 5 or what?
Yeah, here's your window.
Yeah.
It's going to be between October 7th and December 4th.
But it's funny, you can still get Amazon deliveries there within 6 hours. Yeah. We don't know how that works.
I don't know how it works.
You
either.
Order it, 6 hours later, there's somebody at the door up there knocking, but they don't stay. They just stick it right there, and then whatever happens,
some
it happens.
Just
that's
don't
not
make
their
sense.
Responsibility after they take the picture.
That's right.
Very good.
All right. I'll tell you what, I don't know if that would belong. We might want to put something together where we have like the International Space Station and some other things.
Yeah.
For this One Doesn't Belong feature.
Yeah, we'll have to look at that for the future. Sounds very futuristic to me.
You're going
to
put your thinking caps on because I'm going to give you 4 words.
Okay.
And they all but one has something in common. So you have to figure out which one doesn't belong, okay?
All right.
And people at home can play along and help Tim and Dave come up with the right answer if you text 833-598-5959, 833-598-5959, because I think they're going to need a little help, although some of these are easy. You want an easy or a hard one?
Well, this is the thing, and I wanted to say this about the text. I once did a little game show, and it said I had a great opportunity to win big, and they said, phone a friend. I said, I don't have a friend. And they said, well, then you lose. And I'm like, well, that's
phone
not
a stranger.
Fair.
They should
that's
make
not fair.
Action.
All right, 833-598-5959. Mm-hmm. We really need your help. Don't just be a bystander. Be a participant here. 833-598-5959. Now, we get to choose the level of difficulty.
Well, I'm just going to give it to you. Okay. Just tell me how you do.
Now, tell us, is this the level of difficulty on this one easy, medium, or hard?
I would consider it easy.
You would consider this one easy. Okay.
All right.
So the 4 words.
Would you consider it easy like a Sunday morning or easy like a Tuesday afternoon? Okay, here we
over
go.
Easy.
Way to get Lionel
over
Richie
easy.
In here.
Skates, eyeglasses, hairband, socks. Skates, eyeglasses, hairband, socks. And when I say hairband, I'm not talking about Kiss or White
right.
Stripe or anything like that. I'm talking about natural hairband. Yeah,
okay, the thing that bands up here. Yeah, okay. Skates
could be roller or ice.
Okay.
I got this.
Talk,
alrighty.
Talk through it.
Yeah, okay. So skates, you have 2 of them. You have to have 2, unless you want to be a one-footed skater, right? I mean, hey.
It's
up to you. Eyeglasses, you have, obviously, you have, you have to have a right and a left. So yeah, those are 2. Socks, you have 2 of them, but you don't have 2 hair.
Yeah, your philosophy, the eyeglasses, that's not right.
Yeah, but you only have
1
2
eye.
Lenses. You gotta have 2 lenses. Does that make sense?
What do you think, Dave?
No. I don't think that's it.
Okay.
So, skates, eyeglasses, hairband, socks.
It. Yeah.
What do those things have in common?
Skates, eyeglasses, hairband, socks.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
What? You got another
one?
No.
Well, skates and socks go together because they're on your feet, but
I think it's this
hairband.
One. Let me see. Let me see. Okay. I think I have it. Skates, you have to have 2 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Socks, mm-hmm. You have to have 2 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Eyeglasses, now this one might sound a bit, but follow me through on this one. See if you agree with me. Eyeglasses, you have 2 lenses, even though it's, and 2 eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Hairband, it's just a singular thing. What do you think?
Did you get the text help for that?
No, not yet.
All right.
Everybody out there loves
I don't know how he
sweat.
Comes up with this, Ron.
Are you good with that? You want to go
yeah,
with that
I'm good
one?
With
okay,
that.
We're going to go with that one.
Yeah, because the key word here is everything there comes in pairs.
Except
yes.
Hair.
You
band.
Have a pair of glasses.
A pair, right.
Yeah.
So I had
there
it right, but maybe
yeah.
with the wrong idea.
Yeah,
but you had something similar earlier.
Yeah, that was what I
think
said.
You were pretty much
it was
on.
Very, very similar.
I thought. Without,
very similar.
Similar if you mean identical. Yeah.
Here's the thing. Without what you said, I don't think I could have come up with
that's
what
true,
I said.
That's true.
I'm not saying you should get any credit, but you should probably get some credit for at least launching the idea. Nicely done, Producer Tim.
Yes,
I appreciate
nicely,
you.
Nice job.
pink.
Well, I'm proud of both of you. You didn't need any text help on that.
Was that the hard one or the easy one?
Oh, that was the easy
one.
Yeah.
Let's go for the hard one.
You want another one?
Yeah, let's do it. We've got a couple more minutes. Let's try it.
All right, which of these?
Hey, everybody, 833-598-5959. Don't be so standoffish.
Yeah,
we
help
need
them out.
833-598-5959.
So what do these things have in common, except one, of course?
Okay.
Garden, driveway, overpass, tarmac. Garden, driveway, overpass, tarmac.
Okay. I got it.
Boy,
so
he's sharp today.
Yeah. So your driveway, I mean, typically that's,
garden is the one that doesn't belong.
Yeah, garden
right?
doesn't
so
belong.
Driveway, overpass, tarmac.
Because all of them are pavement.
Wait a minute. Rose, overpass.
Overpass is pavement.
But wait a minute. Garden has rows, overpass has a row, and tarmac has a row.
Okay.
So what do we think?
I think it's pavement, but that's just me. Because the garden doesn't have pavement.
Pavement. Tarmac. Pavement. Yep. Garden. Okay, I'm with you.
All right. I tell you, there's two ways to look at this, too.
Yeah.
Because garden's on flat ground, driveway's on flat ground, tarmac's on flat ground, overpass has something under it, right?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
But in this particular instance, the answer is pavement. They are paved, except for the garden.
And you got three, actually, thank you for the participation. You got three pavements and one garden on that. Mm-hmm. So thank you. Thanks, everybody, for chiming in. So, yeah,
okay.
I think pavement. Very nicely done. Nicely done,
right.
Producer
wow.
Tim.
Very
I was going
good.
Garden.
Well done.
All done in a row. But there you go. I like
wow.
it.
I am smarter than the fifth grader.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
All right, that's good. Right. And that one wasn't
you get the award.
As easy, yeah.
See, but that could have gone either way, because the underpass is the only one that has something.
No, right.
It,
everything so. Else was flat.
That made sense.
I could have, done it as a scamp and really
sometimes
made it
this is perception, because as you say, there could be an alternate answer that we're not thinking.
That's right. And some objects in the mirror are larger than they appear. What? Wait a minute.
Yep, another pavement.
I'm always larger than
pavement.
I appear.
That's right.
Garden, another garden, another pavement. There you go.
Well, all you right. did very well today. I'll make it tougher next week.
Appreciate that. Well, maybe not.
Yeah, I think so. I think
kind of like to get them right.
I like to have you struggle a little more than that. Let's pray together, shall we? Our morning offering prayer from one of our listeners.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, I offer you my prayers, joys, works, and sufferings of this day. In union with your Sacred Heart, through the Immaculate Heart of Mary, for the expiation of sins, the furtherment of your kingdom, and for the release of the poor souls in purgatory. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. And we continue our prayers. We invite you to join Parents of Priests and Annunciation Radio as we pray for our clergy and religious. We pray for vocations and for an increase of faith so as to become a more holy diocese of Toledo. Today we pray for Very Reverend Philip Smith.
Dear Lord, we pray that the Blessed Mother wrap her mantle around your priest to follow her own words, do whatever he tells you. May your priest have the heart of St. Joseph, Mary's most chaste spouse. May the Blessed Mother's own pierced heart inspire them to embrace all who suffer at the foot of the cross. May your priest be wholly filled with the fire of your love, seeking nothing but your greater glory and the salvation of souls. Amen. St. John Vianney,
pray for us.
And now we pray a Hail Mary for an increase of vocations in the Diocese of Toledo. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And our word for today on this Thursday, the 27th week in Ordinary Time, this Thursday, October the 12th, our word for today is persistence. Persistence, our word for today, our reading from the book of Malachi, chapter 3. You have defied me in word, says the Lord, yet you ask, what have we spoken against you? You have said, it is vain to serve God, and what do we profit by keeping his command? and going about in penitential dress in awe of the Lord of hosts. Rather, must we call the proud blessed, for indeed evildoers prosper and even tempt God with impunity. Then they who fear the Lord spoke with one another, and the Lord listened attentively. And a record book was written before him of those who fear the Lord and trust in his name. And they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, my own special possession, on the day I take action. And I will have compassion on them, as a man has compassion on his son who serves him. Then you will again see the distinction between the just and the wicked, between the one who serves God and the one who does not serve him. For lo, the day is coming, blazing like an oven, when all the proud and all evildoers will be stubble. And the day that is coming will set them on fire, leaving them neither root nor branch, says the Lord of hosts. But for you who fear my name, there will arise the Sun of Justice with its healing rays. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm number 1, Blessed are they who hope in the Lord. Blessed the man who follows not the counsel of the wicked, nor walks in the way of sinners, nor sits in the company of the insolent, but delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on his law day and night. He is like a tree planted near running water that yields its fruit in due season, whose leaves never fade. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked, not so. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. For the Lord watches over the way of the just, but the way of the wicked vanishes.
Alleluia, alleluia. Open our hearts, O Lord, to listen to the words of your Son. Alleluia, alleluia. Our Holy Gospel from Luke chapter 11. Jesus said to his disciples, Suppose one of you has a friend to whom he goes at midnight and says, Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived at my house from a journey, and I have nothing to offer him. And he says in reply from within, Do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children and I are already in bed. I cannot get up to give you anything. I tell you, if he does not get up to give him the loaves because of their friendship, he will get up and give him whatever he needs because of his persistence. And I tell you, ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be opened. What father among you would hand his son a snake when he asks for a fish, or hand him a scorpion when he asks for an egg? If you then, who are wicked, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?
And our word for today, persistence. Persistence, our word for today. Our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading, these he shared at his general audience on January the 9th, 2019. With these words, Jesus makes it understood that God always responds, that no prayer will remain unheard. Why? Because he is Father and does not forget his suffering children. Of course, these affirmations disconcert us because many of our prayers seem not to obtain any results. Again, of course, these affirmations disconcert us because many of our prayers seem not to obtain any results. How often have we asked and not received? We have all experienced this. How many times have we knocked and found a closed door? Jesus advises us in those moments to persist and to not give up. Prayer always transforms reality. Always. If things around us do not change, at least we change. Our heart changes. Jesus promised the gift of the Holy Spirit to each man and to each woman who prays. We can be certain that God will respond. The only uncertainty is due to time. But let us not doubt that he will respond. Perhaps we will have to persist for our whole life, but he will respond. He promised us this. He is not like a father who gives a serpent instead of a fish. There is nothing more certain. The desire for happiness, which we all carry in our heart, will one day be fulfilled. There is nothing more certain. The desire for happiness, which we all carry in our heart, will one day be fulfilled. Persistence, our word for today. Our Holy Father points out that every prayer is heard. Every prayer is answered, not only heard, but answered. that no prayer will remain unheard. Why? Because he is our Father and does not forget his suffering children. But I love this next line, repeated it twice already, but I'll say it one more time. Of course, these affirmations disconcert us because many of our prayers seem not to obtain any results. I only have one thing to say about that. Amen. My goodness. And it can be frustrating because you don't think that the Lord is hearing you, or at least you're tempted to believe that the Lord is not hearing you. I'll be frank about it. I've just asked the Lord at times, don't you like me? I mean, I'm asking you, I'm talking to you, I'm bringing my broken heart before you, I'm bringing my frustrations before you, I'm bringing my hopelessness before you, I'm coming to you at those times when I am most desperate, and quite frankly, I feel desolate. I don't sense any response from the Lord. And what's the answer to that? I don't know. I'm just saying. It's happened in my own life. I would assume it happens in your life too. So again, I find some consolation with the Holy Father speaking to this because obviously it goes beyond just my own life. Of course, these affirmations, the fact that God always answers prayer, of course, these affirmations disconcert us because many of our prayers seem not to obtain any results. Where we find our consolation, of course, is the fact that God is aware of the big picture. He knows what's best for us, and he knows when the best answer to our prayer is no, and then he also knows when the best answer to our prayer is really no answer at all that we can perceive. But the Holy Father goes on later to say, every prayer is beneficial because it either changes the situation or it changes us. So we know that there's a benefit there, whether we see that benefit or not. Again, maybe it's because the Lord intervenes and works miraculously to resolve the issue that we have come to him with, or he is changing our hearts in the midst of that conversation. And no matter what it is, that persistence is always pays off. Our willingness to go before the Lord to pray always has a benefit. We see it in the book of the prophet Malachi today, chapter 3. After vain people had come up with their own plan, dismissing God, being haughty, then they who fear the Lord spoke with one another. Those who believed came together and spoke with one another, and the Lord listened attentively. And a record book was written before him of those who fear the Lord and trust in his name, and they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, my own special possession on the day I take action. I will have compassion on them as a man has compassion on his son who serves him. This is the distinction, brothers and sisters. This is what the Lord does for those who honor him, who serve him, that there is a recompense for disobedience, and that recompense is coming. I know we keep talking about this grace and mercy, as we should. Everyone has the opportunity to be invited into this right relationship with God, but there comes a time. There will come a time when it is time for judgment, and that judgment, that justice is there at that point. The decisions that you made are weighed out, and they're honored, whether for good or for ill. We have free will, and so you freely choose how that judgment goes based on your response to the invitation that is there. These readings today, particularly this one from the book of the prophet Malachi and certainly from Psalms today, make clear that there is a result associated with the decisions that we made for either blessing or for a curse. That's the way it goes. And so we have an opportunity to say yes today. Say yes to the Lord. Be persistent in prayer. Be persistent in your relationship with him. Be persistent in asking him for all that you need. As our Holy Father says, he answers every prayer, either by administering to the request that you have or by changing your heart. In either case, there's a great benefit there. Persistence, our word for today.
Such a great lesson for us, too, because when we're persistent in prayer, there's always a result. We don't always recognize it, or we forget about it.
Yeah.
We keep praying for a certain thing. If you kept track of all the prayers that you made and then went back later and looked, you'd say, well, wait a minute, that was fulfilled.
Amen.
This prayer was answered to me, and I didn't even recognize it at the time.
And I think that's a great discipline, Ron. Write it down. Mm-hmm. If you're asking the Lord for something, I've done it. I send myself text. Mm. I'm asking the Lord for this. I'm asking for special intercession on that. And then I kind of keep track of it. Do it. Mm-hmm. Other people have other ways of keeping track of things. I like sending texts to myself. But at least I can look it up and say, I asked the Lord for this, and the resolution has been this. And thank you, Lord.
So don't give
up. Easy to lose track.
Don't give up.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dick. Great reflection, man. And, of course, Andrew Reinhardt will come in, and he'll take us into a deep dive in today's readings. And our
He'll knock it out of the park, as they say.
We'll hang in there for that. Lots more to come as well. And just a quick note, you're going to be ducking out a little early today.
Yeah, heading to Canton. A special group heading to Canton with me. We're going to spend some time at Mother Angelica Museum and also going to Rhoda Weiss's house to sit in the Jesus chair. Mm-hmm. Love going to both of those places. Have to admit, one of my favorite places in the world is sitting right there in that mm-hmm. Jesus chair. For those of you who don't know, Servant of God Rhoda Weiss is the woman who prayed over Mother Angelica. Mother Angelica was healed as a teenager. She herself had a healing take place, and then Jesus would come. She was bedridden. Mm-hmm. Jesus would come and visit with her, and when he visited with her, by her own account, he would sit in this chair and talk to her. Mm-hmm. That chair is still there, and now you're invited to sit in it. Called the Jesus chair.
Beautiful.
Yeah, fabulous.
All right. You'll be here for Matthew Archbold, right?
Yep,
okay,
absolutely.
Very good, and bet you didn't know that coming up. Right now, Wendy Sheridan has the latest news.
Thank you, gentlemen, and good morning. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan. Toledo police say a 14-year-old Woodward High School student overdosed at the school yesterday. A report finds the student used a dab pen similar to a vape before it happened. The student was given Narcan, then taken to the hospital. The Lucas County Drug Abuse Response Team says one danger people face when they do drugs is that they might not know what they're taking. It could be laced with other things. TPS confirms it does have overdose-reducing drug Narcan available at schools. Two ProMedica facilities are set to close within the month. The company announced its home health facilities in Clyde and Dundee will close next month. ProMedica released a statement saying it's part of a strategy to get out of the home health care business. The healthcare system says it's working with staff to help them find new jobs and checking in with patients to make sure the transition is a smooth one. Bittersweet Farms celebrating 40 years of service helping people living with autism. There are three locations in Ohio where participants grow and develop their abilities and talents in an agricultural setting. Bittersweet Farms expected to celebrate its past 40 years while looking forward to what's next. Tens of thousands of Israeli troops gathering at the border of Gaza, preparing for a likely ground invasion. President Biden called last weekend's Hamas attack on Israel the deadliest day for Jews since the Holocaust and a campaign of pure cruelty. Israeli airstrikes have been pummeling Gaza for days, leaving many neighborhoods in rubble. On Capitol Hill, Republicans nominated Louisiana Congressman Steve Scalise to be the next Speaker of the House. He narrowly defeated Ohio Congressman Jim Jordan to win his party's nomination. It's not clear when the whole House will vote for a new Speaker. A significant expansion in the auto workers' strike. 8,700 workers at Ford's largest plant walked off the job yesterday. UAW President Sean Fain said the strike was called at the Kentucky truck plant in Louisville after Ford failed to update its contract offer. The automaker is calling the move grossly irresponsible. Researchers in Germany reporting artificial intelligence, or AI, is rapidly improving skin cancer detection. Data shows new software can correctly identify 99.5% of all skin cancers, including 100% of melanoma cases. But healthcare officials also say patients need to consult a dermatologist and not rely solely on artificial intelligence. Somebody's a whole lot richer this morning. One winning ticket for the $1.765 billion Powerball jackpot was sold in California. From the WTOL 11 Weather Center, a very fall-like forecast through the weekend. Rainy today with a high near 60, clouds and 62 tomorrow, and chances of rain again Saturday and Sunday with highs in the upper 50s. In the WTOL 11 newsroom for Annunciation Radio, I'm Wendy Sheridan.
Thank you, Wendy. 51 degrees right now, and time for us to really get ourselves educated.
Yeah, we're going to take a deep dive into the mind of one Matthew Archbold. Good morning, Matthew. How are you this morning?
Don't dive too deep. It's a pretty shallow pool.
Hey, I want to bring this up. When we originally came up with this idea of delving into the mind of one Matthew Archbold, there wasn't a whole lot going on in the world. And sometimes we were really stretching it to kind of come up with stuff to talk about. But since we started this, everything has exploded. Are you responsible for that to give us content for this segment?
That is funny. I have the levers of the world in my dining room.
Leave them alone for a while, please. Let them rest.
That's right. It is funny, you know, years of doing, you know, the blogging and the writing and you know, in the beginning, I really did think to myself, I wonder if there's going to be enough in the world for, you know, of interest to write about. You know, there's always like stupid politics stuff, but nothing important, you know, morally and culturally that really plays to our religion. And boy, was I wrong, because the more you look into it, the more everything is about your religion. And that really, and the older I get, the more I figure out that everything is about my faith. You know, every decision I make, I have to walk in my faith. And it's not something that, you know, it's not a part-time thing anymore. You know, the older I get, I do realize that every little thing, you know, praying is an all-day, every-day activity. It's not something you just do when you're kneeling at Mass.
You know, this the issue going on in Israel, the attack by Hamas, has really brought forward the politics of Israel here in the United States and really exposed some radicals on the other side who aren't even willing to condemn the action of Hamas against Israel. Politicians in our own government.
It really does. These moments do crystallize things, and it helps us see what is really going on. You know, because there's no nuance when it comes to something like this. This is a slaughter. This is barbaric. And yet there are people who are coming out on the wrong side. You know, the number of college students who are protesting and rallying for Hamas and Palestine right now is shocking.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a number of college professors who are doing the same thing. And it's truly shocking, and it really should worry us. And then on the other side, I don't know if you saw this, I literally just put it up. Senator Lindsey Graham is now calling for war against Iran. He said we should start bombing them.
Oh, my goodness.
Immediately. Now, we don't even know for sure. I mean, everyone says they know. But, I mean, after the weapons of mass destruction debacle, do you feel like you know where their funding is from? I don't.
Mm-mm. Even that's one of those things that if that thought is going through your head, you should probably check that thing before you put it down on paper and share it with somebody else, you know?
Yeah, turn that microphone off.
Right. And well, that's not something politicians do. They don't turn microphones off. But it is a really worrisome time, isn't it? You know, when you hear about this stuff and people are reacting as if this is okay, and you had, you know, the Black Lives Matter group endorsing, you know, Hamas and Palestine. You know, you had student groups at Harvard, Columbia, George Washington, you know, rallying for and, you know, writing things in support of Hamas. We really have to look at what we're doing. This one professor at Yale just wrote, "Settlers are not civilians, so therefore they're okay targets."
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, I mean, that's the first step to murder is dehumanization.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, and this not that long ago that happened to this particular group of people. So,
all right, exactly. CreativeMinorityReport.com. Check it out, Matthew Archbold. Have a great day. Thanks.
God bless, guys.
Hi, this is Pat Odie Murray from The Virtuous Life. I hope you'll join us for our next show. Father Phil Smith and Jennifer Oakley from Our Lady of Lourdes will be with us to talk about their new project that they're starting at their parish called The Return Project here on Annunciation Radio.
A recent study was done of teens to see if they could handle being without their screens. The people conducting the study agreed to pull the plug if it got dangerous. The results, quote, only three reached the end of the experiment. Three had suicidal thoughts, five experienced intense panic attacks, 27 had symptoms like nausea, sweating, dizziness, hot flashes, and abdominal pain. Almost everyone had feelings of fear and anxiety. We've all heard the myth that some people are great multitaskers. Not true. Studies have shown that the more things you do at one time, the more you stink at doing all of them. Our brains only have so much bandwidth. If your attention is drawn to a screen, that means it's being drawn away from life all around you. Here's my screen detox challenge. Unplug it every meal. And every Sunday, you'll survive. If you don't get disciplined about unplugging a little, those screens can go from a blessing to an addiction faster than you can say apple. This is Chris Stefanik from RealLifeCatholic.com.
Father Mateo once said, "Make your home another Bethany." Our homes are meant to be holy. Where life is lived, so does our faith need to be lived out as well. When we take time to develop a devotion to His heart, we can experience new graces for daily living, even when life is difficult. The Sacred Heart Enthronement is a powerful way to experience Christ's love. Visit welcomeisheart.com to learn more about the Sacred Heart Enthronement.
Underwriting provided by Rieger's Church Supplies and Religious Gifts, 4100 Secor Road, Toledo. Gifts and keepsakes for First Communion, Confirmation, and other occasions are available at Rieger's, 419-474-4740. Online at Rieger's.com.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
And we're back. It's Morning Offering with Ron and Dave. Ron, I want to say this, and just as a public service announcement to all of those out there, I want to, I did something, and I want to discourage you from doing it. I don't want you to have to repeat it. Maybe you can learn from my own mistake. It's not a good idea or helpful to look for your cell phone using your cell phone flashlight.
Have
you ever done that? I got the flashlight on. I'm looking for my cell phone. I'm like, well, wait a minute. Oh, that is my cell phone. Never mind.
You'll never find it.
Yeah. Always looking for my glasses. They're on the top of my head. Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
Well, we got a lot of stuff yet to come, but you're going to miss some of it because you're going to be leaving a little bit early.
Yeah.
You're going to be driving some pilgrims, if you will.
We're going to have a blast. Yeah.
You got a like one of the stretch vans. And you're actually going to be driving to Canton, despite that suspended license. But you're going to be driving all the way to Canton, and you're going to visit the Mother Angelica Museum and the whole center there, and then you're going to go to Rhoda Wise's house.
Yeah, always one of my favorite things to do. So looking forward to this trip today as well. And so pray for us that it goes well. If you've never made this trip, encourage you at some point to do that. Maybe reach out to me. We'll put together as many trips as people would like to take there, because I think it's personally beneficial, but also obviously beneficial to each person that goes and the group that goes.
Yeah, so, great place to be.
Hope that you'll get there at some time. A wonderful thing to visit the life of Mother Angelica, but also to learn more about the life of Rhoda Wise. I know that many people that we go with really don't know much about her until we go. So
right.
Hope that you'll go. Hey, one of the couples going with us today is a wonderful supporter of Annunciation Radio. Have been for so long, both of them, in fact. But one has a connection to our national day today.
Mm-hmm.
Phil and Jackie Hertzfeld are going with us, and they're farmers.
Yeah.
And so we talked about the fact that today is National Farming Day. Mm-hmm. So I've got some, I bet you didn't know that, facts about the American farmer on this.
Oh, wonderful.
Farmer's Day. Annually, U.S. farmers produce more than $400 billion in crops and livestock, driving the economy and accounting for over 5% of our GDP. This all starts with the 2 million farmers who put their capital at risk each year to produce these goods. 2 million.
Wow.
2 million of us out there farming to produce the food that all of us eat, and then some additional ones as we'll cover in these next points.
Boy, that's a wake-up call.
Yeah, one U.S. farm feeds 166 people on average. One U.S. farm feeds 166 people annually in the U.S. and abroad. The global population is expected to increase by 2.2 billion by 2050, which means the world's farmers will have to grow about 70% more food than what we now produce.
Wow.
So that's less land because they keep taking the land, right, and doing other things with it, but are going to have to produce 70% more food.
Hmm.
In 2018, $139.6 billion worth of American agricultural products were exported around the world. The United States sells more food and fiber to world markets than we import, creating a positive agricultural trade balance.
Huh. So there you go. $139.6 billion.
Yeah, and that's, what, 5 years ago. So who knows where we're at now.
Wow.
But, you know, $150 billion, something like that. But here is the thing. We feed ourselves and we actually feed others because our export is greater than our import when it comes to agriculture. So thank you to a farmer today.
Yeah,
thank
God
you
bless
in particular
farmers.
To the farmers with us right now, Phil and Jackie Hertzfeld. But thank you to all of you who farm and make our lives possible. Thank you. That's low. I bet you didn't know that. I know I didn't. And now for Heroes of the Faith.
Yeah. And you know what today is, October the 12th, is the Feast of Blessed Carlo Acutis.
Mm.
And, of course,
that's right.
We know a bit about him, thanks to this year of Eucharistic revival, teenage layman in the Archdiocese of Milan, Italy. Known for creating a series of websites devoted to church-related supernatural events, especially Eucharistic miracles. And as a regular teenage boy, he loved comics. He loved computer programming and video editing and related matters. He was known at his school for defending other kids, especially those with disabilities, from bullies. Now, he was born in London, England in 1991. He died in Milan, Italy, of leukemia. And venerated by Pope Francis in 2018 and then beatified after that. He was beatified on the 10th of October in 2020 by Pope Francis, a beatification miracle involving the 2013 healing of a child in Brazil who was healed of a pancreatic cancer. And some things that you may or may not know about Blessed Carlo. His parents were working there in London. That's why he was born there. Mm. He moved with his parents to Milan, and he was diagnosed with leukemia as a teenager. He offered his sufferings, even as a teenager, for Pope Benedict XVI and the Church, saying, "I offer all the sufferings I have to suffer, or I will have to suffer, for the Lord, the Pope, and the Church."
Mm.
And he died 2006 on October 12th, buried in Assisi at his request because of his love for St. Francis of Assisi. And as I mentioned, his cause for canonization began in 2013, declared venerable in 2018, and blessed in 2020. And from a young age, Carlo had a special love for God, even though his parents weren't especially devout. In fact, Antonia Salzano, his mom, said that before Carlo, she just went to Mass only for her First Communion, her confirmation, and her wedding. But as a young child, Carlo loved to pray the rosary. After he made his First Communion, he went to Mass as often as he could and made holy hours before and after Mass. He went to confession every week, and he asked his parents to take him on pilgrimages so he could see the places of the saints and the sites of Eucharistic miracles. Carlo's witness of faith led to a deep conversion in his mom, which she has talked about frequently. He was known for defending kids who were bullied at school, especially those with disabilities. And when a friend's parents were getting a divorce, Carlo made a special effort to include his friend in the Acutis family life. He was also a programmer, built a website cataloging and promoting Eucharistic miracles, and he told people that the more often we receive the Eucharist, the more we will become like Jesus, so that on this earth we will have a foretaste of heaven. And we know that he loved playing video games.
Yeah.
His favorite console, his console of choice, do you know?
I've heard this before, but no, I don't recall.
It was a PlayStation.
Yeah.
Or perhaps a PS2, which was released in 2000 when Carlo was 9 years old. But he only allowed himself to play games for an hour a week.
A week?
as a penance and a spiritual discipline.
Oh, my goodness.
But he wanted to play much more.
And he set those parameters up. Yeah.
Initially, those reports that Carlo's body was found to be incorrupt, and a spokeswoman for his beatification told Catholic news agency the entire body was present when it was exhumed, but not incorrupt.
Mm.
So his body, however, lies in repose in a glass tomb where he was venerated by pilgrims until October 17th, 2020. He's displayed in jeans and a pair of Nikes, so we've seen those pictures, or maybe you've actually had a chance to visit there, and that's what he preferred to wear in life. And his heart, which is now considered a relic, is displayed in a reliquary in the Basilica of St. Francis Assisi, St. Dominic Parish in Brick, New Jersey. Also received a first-class relic from Carlo's mom in 2023, just October 1st
of this year.
So after the celebration of Mass, she took the relic of her son from the hands of Bishop David O'Connell of the Diocese of Trenton, and together they processed to the narthex where a new shrine to Carlo was blessed.
Oh, my gosh.
Was blessed.
I did not know that.
Yeah, so, yeah, just an amazing young man, and we can still learn so much for Blessed Carlo Acutis. Of course, he was the patron of World Day, World Youth Day 2023, and a patron of youth, rightfully so, and of computer programmers.
Gotta love it. And the more you find out about him, the more you admire everything that he did and look to him as a wonderful guide for us. I do want to say this real quickly because my time is running out. I'm going to be heading to Canton, departing from the show here in just a couple of minutes. Please pray for Phil and Jackie Hertzfeld, Mike and Marilyn Lang, who are accompanying me to Canton, because they are accompanying me to Canton. They're going to be spending 2.5 hours in a vehicle with me, then all day, and then 2.5 hours in a vehicle with me on the way back. But
well, you're fun to travel with.
Yeah, please pray for a wonderful spiritual day in Canton, Ohio.
I would just encourage them in the back of that van to about every 5 minutes say, "Are we there yet?"
Welcome to Catechism for Today with Father Nicholas Weibel. Lessons for daily life from the Catechism of the Catholic Church.
Why should I pray? I pray because prayer affects me. Praying helps me realize that there's a God. God loves me, that I need God, that the gifts God gives me are far, far beyond me. It points me in the right direction. Little children are taught to make cards for their mothers on Mother's Day. The mothers don't need the cards, but the children do. The children realize how much their mothers do for them, how much their mothers love them. It sets the children in the right direction. And what does the Catechism say about this? Paragraph 2744. Prayer is a vital necessity. Proof from the contrary is no less convincing. If we do not allow the Spirit to lead us, we fall back in the slavery of sin. How can the Holy Spirit be our life if our heart is far from Him? St. John Chrysostom wrote, "Nothing is equal to prayer. What is impossible, it makes possible. What is difficult, easy. For it is impossible, utterly impossible, for a man who prays eagerly and invokes God ceaselessly ever to sin." And St. Alphonsus Liguori, "Those who pray are certainly saved. Those who do not pray are certainly damned." Paragraph 2745. Prayer and the Christian life are inseparable, for they concern the same love and the same renunciation proceeding from love, the same filial and loving conformity with the Father's plan of love, the same transforming union in the Holy Spirit who conforms us more and more to Christ Jesus, the same love for all men, the love with which Jesus has loved us. And whatever you ask the Father in my name, He will give to you, as I command you, love one another. If today you hear His voice, harden not your hearts.
Local, live, and Catholic. Welcome to Morning Offering with Ron and Dave on Annunciation Radio. Here are your hosts, Ron Finn and Dave Vacheresse.
Well, Dave just stepped out. He's getting ready to get behind the wheel of a 15-passenger van and wind his way to Canton, Ohio. So just stepping out a little early this morning. And, yeah, I wish him a great trip. And, of course, all the passengers that are going along, those that went with us on the trip recently, I really learned a lot about not only Mother Angelica but also about Rhoda Wise as well. So it's going to be a wonderful trip. And glad they could make it today. And there's a few other things going on, too. If you look at the events calendar, we know, let's see, the Young Catholic Professionals gathering today, this evening, from 7 to 9 p.m. It's a happy hour at Stubborn Brothers Pizza Bar on West Bancroft in Toledo. And the Young Catholic Professionals Toledo Happy Hour is becoming a very popular event, as are there other events as well. You can learn more about the group and about the events at youngcatholicprofessionals.org. Just look for the Toledo chapter, but that again is tonight, 7 to 9 p.m. And then tomorrow, if you're going to the Central Catholic St. Francis de Sales football game, you're going to be participating in the National Faith in Blue Weekend. And here in our area, of course, Bishop Daniel E. Thomas and the Roman Catholic Faithful of the Diocese joining forces with Toledo Police Department for National Faith in Blue Weekend. And this includes a parking lot tailgate event. It's a food drive for Helping Hands of St. Louis. And you'll be able to bring your non-perishables between 3 and 6 p.m. to the football game. It's a tailgate party there in the parking lot of Central Catholic on Cherry Street. There's going to be a presentation at 5 p.m. So yeah, if you're going to the game, and if you're not going to the game, if you just want to go to the tailgate event, go ahead and do that. That's tomorrow evening. And then Saturday, Kevin Jory, Protect Them Both presentation, educating, equipping, and activating the faithful in the fight to build a culture of life, and learn why we need to vote no on Dangerous Issue 1 in November. That's going to be at St. Joe's, Sylvania. Kevin will be speaking at 9 a.m. The doors open at 8:30 a.m. on Saturday. Also Saturday, maybe on the way home from that, you'll swing by the St. Joan of Arc Knights of Columbus barbecue chicken dinner. Carry-out dinner is $12, and it's loaded. Everything you need is right there, and that's right there at St. Joan of Arc on Heather Downs at Perrysburg Holland Road. And then the door-knocking campaign volunteer sign-ups taking place this weekend. Volunteers needed to hit the streets to urge residents to vote no on Issue 1, and you can sign up at volunteer.createdequal.org. They'll provide all the resources and all the training absolutely free. And then finally on Saturday, the 17th annual Red Mass at Our Lady Queen of the Most Holy Rosary Cathedral for the legal community on this feast of St. Thomas More. So there you go. That's a look at what's going on. And then Sunday, by the way, you can head out to a great parish festival. It's the Holy Trinity Assumption Fall Festival. They'll have turkey and roast beef dinner starting at 11:30 a.m. and games and activities for the family right there on Route 20 in Swanton at Holy Trinity. So that's a look at what's going on in and around the area. If you've got something that you want us to publicize, we're happy to do it. Just email info@annunciationradio.com and we'll make sure we mention it. And our word for today, persistence. And here with his thoughts on today's word of the day, it's Andrew Reinhardt. Good morning, Andrew.
Good morning, Ron. And we'll see you, Dave. He's driving away.
Yeah, there he goes.
So you've put me in front of a lot of buttons here.
Uh-huh.
And I am very tempted to give myself some theme music, but I'll hold off today.
We'll find some for you if you'd like.
I'm sitting in Dave's seat. So our word for the day is persistence. Persistence. And this word is... it's a beautiful idea, and I'm going to explain a little bit of it from our philosophical and theological tradition in the church. See, different virtues have traditionally been considered parts or related to the cardinal virtues. And those four cardinal virtues, or you might think of them as the kind of keystone virtues or the heart of the virtuous life, are prudence, justice, temperance, and courage. Mm-hmm. And courage is a synonym with fortitude.
Yeah.
So fortitude. So this persistence was classically considered a part of courage, a part of fortitude. So persistence is a part of fortitude. But what is courage and fortitude? First, the word courage, the kind of beginning of the word comes from the word core, which means heart. So courage comes from the word for heart, take heart. But part of the way that courage functions in the human person is it's our ability to deal with our emotions, but the particular emotions when we're dealing with something difficult or something frightening or something hard, something arduous. So to have courage is to have a right relationship, a right ordering of yourself in relationship to things that are scary or difficult. And so in light of this, it's important to understand that the difference between virtue and vice isn't like two neutral options that you get to choose between, and you, it's sort of good or bad based on what you want. No, virtue is the function of the human person. So to have courage is the right relationship to what's difficult, what's arduous, what's scary. And then to be fearful, to act without courage, to act out of this place of smallness of self, would really be a dysfunction of the human person in relationship to something that's difficult, arduous, or scary. See, like all the other things in creation that don't have free will, they just are what they are. A tree doesn't have to work to be like a tree. A fox doesn't have to work on its foxiness, mm-hmm. right? It comes up naturally from its being. But since we have free will, we can either choose to act like a human or choose to not act like a human. To be virtuous is to choose to act like a human, and to choose to be vicious, to choose what's bad and sinful, is actually to act in an inhuman way. And so it's a dysfunction within the core of the human person. So this courage is really the right functioning of the human heart. This place of choice, this place of deep in our soul, the covenant calls the heart the place of the covenant.
Yeah.
So we're presented with this word today, persistence. Persistence. And after Jesus encourages his followers to be persistent, he tells them this story where he talks about a father. And he says, "For everyone who asks, receive, and the one who seeks, find, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. What father among you will hand his son a snake when he asks for a fish, or hand him a scorpion when he asks for an egg? If you then, who are wicked, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Now note with the image here of fatherhood, of love, of paternal love, of acceptance, of and basically saying, like, you all do pretty well with your kids. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm a lot better than you. And so I'm doing well with you. But notice in the end what the father gives to his child. It says the Father in heaven will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him. Will give the Holy Spirit. Who's the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit's God. Right? The Father gives himself. God gives himself. God doesn't create some kind of a like divine currency to give us or give us the things of the world. He gives us himself. So we're called to be persistent in asking for our needs. But God's response always teaches us about what's best for us, about the reality of the situation, right? How we can truly flourish, right? Because I think sometimes we ask for things in a way that isn't good for us, or it's beyond our comprehension what we actually need, or we don't see our life in the context of our eternity, so we don't know what to truly ask for. You know, I often think of myself, we have a baby and a toddler at home, mm-hmm. you know, and every time my toddler tries to solve a problem, he typically makes more of a mess, right? And the difference between me and God is much greater than the difference between me and my toddler. So how much more am I likely to make a mess when I try to fix things on my own?
Oh, amen.
Right? So regardless of God's answer to our particular request, he always gives us himself, which is what we actually truly need. So today our word is persistence. And whether or not God is literally answering the words that you're asking him to give you, he's always giving you himself. And that's the greatest gift of all.
Boy, amen. That's a beautiful analogy there. And if our prayer in persistence to desire what God desires for us, and I mean, if we're in union with that, he is showering the Holy Spirit on us. And when you talk about courage and the heart, if you're stout-hearted, right, then you're kind of steeled against all the foes that come at you, all the evils that you're confronted with, and all the difficulties that you face in life. That persistence in prayer sustains you as long as you're stout of heart.
Amen, amen. And sometimes those difficulties are hidden, right? We don't think it should be difficult, but it is. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that email that shows up in your inbox and causes you a great amount of anxiety. It's that text message that you don't understand, and so you start to worry about a relationship with a friend or family member. It's that person who maybe doesn't call you back and you wonder why. Mm-hmm. Right? There's all of these seemingly small things that can really move us, can cause fear, can cause anxiety, can cause trouble. And so I think the Lord even wants us to bring those small things to him and to persist in that continuous relationship of love where he always gives us himself.
Beautiful. Once again, a wonderful reflection, and it's amazing too because you've got a baby at home, and I know you can't be getting too much sleep. So, but you're sharp as a tack. We appreciate that.
Oh well, last night was blessed. 8 hours, no interruption.
Wow.
Which probably means my wife was awake all night.
Probably.
God bless her.
So it'll be your turn tonight.
Yeah.
That's the way that works. All right, Andrew Reinhardt, thank you so much, and Dave, safe travels to Canton. We will regroup. Tomorrow morning, God willing, morning offering for Friday here on Annunciation Radio. Thanks for joining us.